Vida. I know it's been a while without us making videos, but we're finally back on track. And in today's lesson, we are going to learn the difference between por and para, which can sometimes be tricky because there's cases where they can both be translated as for. This is for you, this pen is for writing, etc. But they don't always mean for. And so we're going to be talking about the uses of each, and I'll be giving examples, and hopefully that'll give you a better insight and idea on when to use each one of them, okay? And so we're going to begin with por. The first thing we use por for is to talk about the cause of something. So in English, it could be translated as because of, or even due to, okay? An example. Anoche no pude dormir por el ruido, okay? Last night, I was not able to sleep because of the noise. That's the cause, that's the reason why you couldn't sleep. So, we're going to be using por, okay? No pude dormir por el ruido, okay? Or, for example, you could say, no pude concentrarme por el calor. Okay, I couldn't focus because of the heat. It was so hot, I couldn't focus. I was getting sleepy, okay? No pude concentrarme por el calor. Okay, good. Or por el cansancio, due to my tiredness or because I was so tired, okay? Good. The next one, we use it when we're talking about an approximate time frame or an approximate place. So when we imagine we're trying to make plans and we're saying, where should we meet? And we say, oh, let's meet around downtown, or let's meet around this place. Then we're going to be using por, okay? ¿Por qué no quedamos por el centro? Why don't we meet up around, you know, the downtown? ¿Por qué no quedamos por el centro? Okay? Or, yesterday I was walking around the park when this happened, okay? Estaba paseando por el parque cuando... I don't know, I bumped into a friend of mine, for example, okay? So you're not saying, I was at the entrance of the museum, or I was in my bedroom, or I was in the corner with, you know, 5th Avenue and 10th Street. You're not, like, talking about a specific place. You're saying around, okay? Good. Or we were around the airport when we saw the accident, or when we saw that our flight had been cancelled. It's always an approximate place, okay? You're not saying in front of the information desk, okay? Does that make sense? Awesome. Then, regarding the tiempo aproximado, for example, if someone were to ask me, Marta, ¿cuándo vas a España? Marta, when are you going to Spain? And I can say, no lo sé, a lo mejor por julio, maybe around July, but I'm not sure about the exact dates yet. I haven't purchased a flight ticket. So I say sometime around July. Por julio, okay? Or por finales, maybe por finales de agosto. I don't know yet, okay? Good. Then, also with complementos agentes, what does it mean? What does this mean? You might be wondering. When we say who did an action, for example, Harry Potter was written by J.K. Rowling. By, okay, is por in Spanish. Harry Potter fue escrito por J.K. Rowling, okay? Good. Well, this building, okay, this museum was built by whoever, okay? Este museo fue construido por, okay? So, who did something? Por, by. Good. Also, when we're talking about a means, okay, about the means of doing something, or when we say things such as to talk on the phone, okay, through the phone, it's the means, okay, through which you're talking and communicating, then we also use por. Hablar por teléfono, okay? Hablar por Skype, to talk on Skype. Hablar por Facebook, to talk on Facebook, okay? Yes? Or to send something via fax. You could say via fax or por fax. Or to send something via email. Enviar algo por correo electrónico. That's the mean you're using, okay? So it's like saying through. also, when we're literally going through a place, then you're also going to say bored. For example, he threw that, I guess you could say, out of the window, through the window. Or he came in the house, he broke into the house, through the window. I know that's an awful example, but we use por because that person is literally going through the window, okay? Good. Or the dog escaped through the door. El perro se escapó por la puerta. So it is a synonym of through, okay? Good. Or, for example, what else? Por it just means through, okay? Por, okay? Good. Also, intercambio o compra. Compra, if I say, if you know, someone has this pen and I love it and I want to buy it. So I say, I'll give you $2 for that pen. Te doy $2 por este boli. Okay? Good. Or for how much would you sell me this pen? ¿Por cuánto me venderías este boli? Okay? Yes? So, compra. Okay? Or if I said, I bought those concert tickets for $20. Compré esas entradas por $20. That's how much they cost. That's how much you paid for them. Okay? Pagué $20 por ellas, for them. Yeah? Or intercambio. Okay? I'll give you this pen for that other pen you have. I'll give you my phone for your phone. It's an exchange, you're trading, okay? We're also gonna use por, okay? Or if I said, what would you give me for this pen? ¿Qué me das por este boli? Again, exchange, trade, por, never para. Awesome. And then the last one, distribution. For example, I think in English you guys would say per, like per person. Four slices of pizza per person. There were four slices of pizza per person. Había o hubo cuatro, okay? Cuatro trozos de pizza por persona, okay? Or if I bake cookies and I start counting them to see how many cookies each person could have, and I say, okay, hay galletas, let's see, tocamos a cuatro galletas por persona, four cookies per person, okay? Again, we're distributing things, okay? Good. Also, let's see. Also, when we say percent, the expression percent, 5%, we say por ciento, because that's another way of distributing things, okay? Por ciento. Awesome. So that's basically what we use por for. I did want to include one more use that I haven't written here, because I've noticed that that use is mainly used in Latin America because of the influence of English. We don't really use it in Spain as much. And again, if we do, if you hear it, it is the influence of English. But it's not as common, I believe. I never used it that way anyway. And you might be wondering, what use is this? It's when we say things like, I went to England for 5 weeks last year. Fui a Inglaterra por 5 semanas la semana pasada. Did I say last week or last year? El año pasado, la semana pasada. Whatever. But just using por to talk about duration, to talk about how long you did something for. Or, estudié por 3 horas ayer. I studied for 3 hours yesterday. So, it's not incorrect, okay? You'll hear it and it's perfectly correct, it's perfectly fine, but just be aware that that's the influence of English. So, we would just say, estudié 3 horas ayer. We don't use any preposition. Estudié 3 horas ayer. And if you wanted to use one, then we would say, durante. Estudié durante, during. Estudié durante 3 horas ayer, okay? O fui a Inglaterra durante 3 semanas. O fui a Inglaterra 3 semanas. I went to England 3 weeks. That would be the literal translation, okay? We don't use a preposition. And then if we do, it's during, okay? Durante, or just nothing at all. Fui a Inglaterra 3 semanas, okay? Good. So then let's move on to talk about para. Para, the first use, okay, is when we talk about the purpose of something. Why? So what we do something for? Why do we do something? What's the end? What's the purpose of that? For example, if I were to say, I'm going to Boston this summer to learn English. To learn. para aprender. Voy a Boston este verano para aprender inglés. To learn, okay? That's the finalidad, that's the purpose, okay? So, finalidad, propósito, okay? Or imagine that I bought the newest computer and a friend of mine says, what do you want this for? ¿Para qué? ¿Para qué necesitas un ordenador tan caro? Why do, like, what do you need such an expensive computer for? Okay? Or what is this for? ¿Para qué es esto? Este boli es para escribir. That's the purpose, okay? This pen is for writing. Para escribir. Okay? Good. Well, this is for you to take notes. Para que tomes apuntes. Okay? Good. Next one. Destinatario. Who's receiving something? Or who's receiving... Who's the receiver of an action? Okay? So if I were to say, this present is for you. Este regalo es para ti. Okay? You are the one who's getting that present. Okay? You are the destinatario because you're the one who's getting that. Okay? Esto es para ti. ¿De acuerdo? Good. Or I baked these cookies for you. Estas galletas son para ti. ¿De acuerdo? Good. Or I'm here for you. Estoy aquí para ti. Para ayudarte. To help you. Again, the purpose of something. I'm here to help you. Estoy aquí para ayudarte. Okay? Good. Also, we use para to talk about, well, to give our opinion, to be honest. So, for example, I could say, para mí, las matemáticas son muy difíciles. Okay? Like, my opinion, for me, math is really difficult. Para mí, en mi opinión, las matemáticas son muy difíciles. But also, imagine you're with a friend and you're talking to someone else and you guys can tell that person is not being completely honest, okay? And then your friend could say, no sé, para mí que esa persona no te está diciendo la verdad. Para mí, okay, like, if you want my opinion, in my opinion, that person is not telling you the truth. Para mí, esa persona, para mí que esa persona no te está diciendo la verdad, okay? So again, just so that you know, that's another use. It's a little bit more advanced, but just so that you know, okay, if you hear it, people can also give their opinion using para, okay? Good. Also, when we're talking about the direction, so it's just another way of saying a, okay? Vamos para la playa este verano, okay? We're going to the beach this summer. Vamos a la playa or vamos para la playa, ¿de acuerdo? Also really common to hear. Next one, for deadlines and due dates, if I say, this assignment is due tomorrow, okay? Este trabajo es para mañana. ¿De acuerdo? Para mañana. Yes? Good. Or we, let's see, also by, like we need to do this by Monday. Tenemos que hacer esto para el lunes. ¿De acuerdo? Esto tiene que estar listo para el lunes. This has to be ready by Monday, okay? Deadlines. Good. And then the last one, again, this one's more advanced, and when I teach it to my students, this is the only one that I say, I don't expect you to know how to use it right away, but at least just be aware that it exists and that you're gonna hear it, okay? But basically, para can be used to basically signify a sentence with the word although. So I'm gonna give an example and it'll make more sense. This one I am gonna write down. So let's pretend I wanna say, Para ser abril, and this is actually applicable because it's been very cold this April. Para ser abril, okay, hace mucho, mucho frío. I'm gonna give you a minute, okay, read that sentence, try to figure out what it could mean. Para ser abril, hace mucho frío. So, if I'm telling you that this is the same as a sentence that begins with although, then it's like saying, although it's April, it's really cold. Like, it's really cold for April, okay? That's what it means. It's really cold for April. Or although it's April, it's really cold. So, instead of saying, para ser abril, hace mucho frío, another way of saying this with aunque would be, aunque es abril, hace mucho frío. Okay? Yes? Awesome. Perfecto! So guys, I hope this was helpful. Please let me know if you have any questions. But I do have one last sentence for you to try to see if it's por or para. If I were to say, thank you for the photos, por o para? Do we say, gracias por las fotos o gracias para las fotos? You have 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Por, okay? Gracias por las fotos. Why? Because that's the reason why you're thanking them. That's the cause, okay? Thank you. Gracias por las fotos. Okay, guys, well, thank you so much for paying attention. Please use the comments below to ask me if you have any questions, suggestions for future videos, okay? I'm always accepting suggestions. And please do not forget to subscribe to my channel and click on the bell. Thank you so much. Bye.